Mr. John Wiley, President of the Library Board of Victoria, Mrs. Miriam Bouvier Wiley, Honorary Consul General for France, Ms. Kate Tawney, CEO of the State Library, all the distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Could I start too, please, by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land on which we're gathering and pay my respects to their elders past and present and any elders who are with us this evening. Well, about 8 years ago, I sat down at a dinner at a friend's home next to a man I'd not met before. Our friend was a very good hostess, and before she moved to her end of the table, she gave us a conversation opener, as a very good hostess is inclined to do. "So and so," she said, "this is Linda, she's an AFL commissioner." A funny choice of descriptor, I note as an aside, not Linda as a judge or a fabulous wife and mother, okay, nor any reference to any other organisations or interests of mine. So, Linda as an AFL commissioner is what she left us with. I smiled towards my dinner companion, and I expected things would go quite well between us. At a dinner in Melbourne, an AFL reference is usually quite a good way of getting things started. And so I was taken somewhat aback when my companion's opening salvo was to this succinct effect. "Well, I'm not the least bit interested in football, I'm into the arts." Now, I had no more than a split second to decide whether or not I'd be better behaved than he was. And before I exercised any choice in the matter, my equally succinct reply tumbled out, "Sorry, I didn't know we had to choose," I said, possibly just a little bit too abruptly. So what I'd say is it was a very long dinner. As it turned out, the experience was not an isolated one. It's a paradox, I thought, that when we live in a city and a state that loves both sport and the arts, some people seem to show discomfort in saying that they love them both. I know that's not the case for everyone. Certainly two of my fellow AFL commissioners in Sam Mostyn and Kim Williams are ardent supporters of footy and equally engaged in the arts. For her part, Sam has held many prominent arts roles and is currently chair of Carriage Works in Sydney and a member of the Australian Council for the Arts. And she is, of course, the first female commissioner of the AFL. And I've said before, and I'll say again, I was the second, and if I have to come second to anyone, I'm glad that it's her, because she's a very talented person. Kim Williams, for his part, is a former chair of the Sydney Opera House Trust and Musica Viva Australia, as well as a clarinet player and a composer, having studied at the Sydney Conservatorium of Music. Lee Clifford, on the other hand, with whom I served on the Council of the National Gallery of Victoria, is a renowned supporter of the gallery and an equally committed supporter of a football club. Well, not just any football club, the Essendon Football Club. I thought I'd get that on the table early, sorry. But it doesn't diminish my point that there is frequently an abyss of misunderstanding between what effectively become two distinct camps, one being sport, the other the arts. And I've felt myself caught in that abyss on many occasions with conversations at dinner such as the one that I just recounted. And so, as Governor of Victoria and with my own topic to choose this evening, I thought I'd deal head on with why sport really matters and why the arts really matter and why both really matter. So let me start unabashedly by talking about the joy and beauty of both sport and the arts. Now, for some, this won't be my strongest and most persuasive point. And I know I start here at my own peril, 40 years in the courts, having taught me that you're meant to always lead with your absolutely strongest point. But I'm old enough and probably sort of risky enough now with what I do that I can defy that learning and start where I think I should start. And that's by saying that both sport and the arts are quite simply beautiful, just a joy to experience. Can you imagine anything more beautiful than Gary Ablett Jr.'s elegant balance that so often leaves a multitude of opponents in his wake before he snaps seemingly easy goals from the boundary. Or the grace and exuberance of Cathy Freeman's great win on home soil at the Sydney Olympics. Or perhaps the captivating tension of John Aloisi's final penalty kick for Australia to defeat powerhouse Uruguay and qualify for the Soccer World Cup for the first time in 32 years. Or for that matter, Australia 2's 41-second winning margin that broke the until then uninterrupted 132-year winning streak of the America's Cup. I can't imagine anything more beautiful or more stirring to the senses, but I can imagine something equally beautiful. I can imagine that equal beauty in the enigmatic smile of Da Vinci's Mona Lisa, the glorious sweep of Michelangelo's Sistine ceiling, or his perfectly proportioned David, the wonder of Jeff Koons's giant floral puppy, Christo's wrapped up Grand Canyon, Samuel Taylor Coleridge's Ancient Mariner with water everywhere, Margaret Atwood's perfect prose, Brahms' Violin Concerto in D major, or almost anything written by Giuseppe Verdi. So who is it to say that whether it's black caviar or the black-eyed peas that makes your heart beat just that little bit faster or better or even make your heart sing? So while one of us will hold our breath and marvel as a lightly framed woman tumbles 20 metres through the air to land elegantly on icy snow, another amongst us will most certainly breathe in at the wonder and detail of Caravaggio's depiction of the Madonna di Loreto. To my mind, neither is better or best. As to the beauty of art, philosopher Alain de Botton is definitely the philosopher du jour. He talks of art as quite simply a vital source of humanity. He describes it as an emblem of hope, saving us from slipping into despair, overborne by the terrible problems that weigh on the world. He says that art makes us less lonely, that when we see that pain and sadness are normal, we realise they're just part of the human condition. He says that art rebalances us, providing the perfect counterbalance to what might be lacking in us or what might just need a boost. And finally, he says something I like very much, and that is that art just helps us appreciate stuff, like a beautiful sky or an everyday object. He describes it as propaganda for what really matters. Mind you, recently researching the composer Mendelssohn for the 3MBS Mendelssohn Marathon on the 28th of February, tickets are still available, I'm a patron, my interest peaked once I discovered that Mendelssohn's father's surname had originally been the same as mine before they changed it. That's not really relevant to anything, but it did make me pay extra attention when I was doing this research. And I particularly enjoyed Mendelssohn's simple but profound description that, quote, life and art are not two different things, unquote. Well, as to the beauty of sport, I like well-known sports administrator Greg Hartung's description in Spirit in Australian Sport. He refers to the timelessness of sport and that it provides a link between Australians of succeeding generations, whether urging on a Bradman or cheering and rejoicing in the America's Cup victory. He says, call it the spirit, the soul of sport, but it will be the same in 2001 as it was in 1901. The international chair of the Special Olympics captured for me the true joy of sporting achievement when he said that the glory of sport is within the moment, when the game and the person become one, when all the complexity of one's life finds a moment of convergence. Personally, I identify with that moment of convergence, and I'm not even playing the sport, I'm only just watching. A few years ago, Tony and I went to a health farm. Anyone who's done that will know the process. It usually starts with individual assessments to gauge your physical and mental state. For me, the physical part was dealt with well enough. That is, it was immediately clear that I needed to exercise more. The mental health assessment did not go as smoothly. There was no real meeting of minds between the young man conducting the conversation and me. I sensed he was becoming a little impatient when I insisted I felt fine and simply needed to lose a kilo or two. Desperately wanting to draw me on my mental health, he finally said, "Look, tell me when you last experienced a moment of total and unfettered ecstasy." Don't get anxious. Governors don't talk like that. Don't get anxious. He seemed so pleased with himself when I said immediately, "Oh, that's easy. It was September 2000. He leant forward in a very meaningful gesture and he encouraged me to keep talking, although in truth I didn't need any encouragement. I was reliving to him the moment when Essendon had won the 2000 Premiership flag. I wasn't trying to be cute either. It truly was that moment of convergence. Nothing else mattered. Our team song played over and over, and it sounded so good. Not the least bit repetitive, which I found Brisbane's song sounded in 2001, strangely enough. Well, it's like, do we have to listen to that again? My New Age counsellor looked so deflated. He was, after all, from New South Wales. So he just didn't understand I was telling the truth. One of my favourite writers is a Financial Times journalist, Simon Cooper. He writes a lot about the other football, soccer, and about the economics of soccer. He captured the pleasure for me, though, of watching sport when he described it as one of the comforting rituals that carries you through life. I particularly relate to his view that in the stadium, everyone becomes 9 years old again. Once more, on a personal note, one of the great joys of sport, in my mind, is that it's not only a wonderful interest to share with your children, but it can help you through the sometimes dark teenage years, particularly when sons tend to do no more than grunt, or at least they talk to you in particularly short sentences. There was a year when the progress of Matty Lloyd's injuries sustained my relationship with one of our boys. Fortunately, by the end of the season, Lloyd was just fine, and so was our lovely son, who had thankfully outgrown that stage. Before leaving the topic of joy, in my view, the joy of the arts and of sport is not only equal in stature and pleasure, but the pleasure quotient is exponentially increased when they both intersect. Do yourself a favour when you leave here this evening. Go home and watch the YouTube clip of Cyril Rioli twisting, diving, and elegantly kicking the Sharon, as if it's round and cooperative and we know that it's not, to the aptly named Magic Man soundtrack, sung in the haunting tones of Jeffrey Gurumul Yanupingu. Visit the Hermannsburg Potters' Our Land is Alive exhibition at the National Gallery of Victoria, which is on still until April, and enjoy the juncture between a beautifully crafted and painted clay pot illustrated with the iconic image of Nicky Winmar lifting his jumper and pointing proudly at his black chest. And bask in the vision and enjoy the spoils of the Basil Sellers Art Prize, the $100,000 acquisition award that is so generously given to encourage contemporary artists to engage with the many themes within sport, past and present, to critically reflect on sporting culture in Australia. Enough about joy, if that's possible, I don't know. Enough about joy, let me talk about health. In most regards, it's probably going to be fair to say that it's sport that wins the day when it comes to good health, that is, good physical health. Although there are artists who can shimmy into their 70s, like Mick Jagger, or dance like an angel, like Sylvie Guillaume, fly effortlessly through the air like any circus performer, or manage to manoeuvre and carve heavy stone so that they are undoubtedly too in peak physical condition. Overall, though, it must be those who run, cycle, swim, climb, throw, or even drive, ride, or walk who are likely to be the physically fitter. It looks like a big tick to sport, but reserve your judgment for a moment. Let's see how the ledger plays out. When it comes to participation in sport and exercise, research in 2014 showed that 45% of adults regularly go walking. It's the nation's clearly favoured sport or recreational activity overall. One in seven Australians regularly swim. I'm married to one of them. One in nine cycle, one in 12 play soccer. And nearly half of all our Australian children regularly go swimming or play soccer. In fact, heading towards 40% of them cycle, and over 30% of our kids in this country are engaged in athletics, basketball, or dancing. And I'm happy to include dancing as both sport and art because I think it can fall either way. Add in cricket, netball, tennis, gymnastics, AFL, hiking, rugby, softball, martial arts, volleyball, baseball, hockey, badminton, and the list goes on and on. It means there's an awful lot of young people doing an awful lot of different sports, and so there should be. Australia's battle with obesity and its associated chronic illnesses is very well known to us all. Obesity remains the single biggest threat to public health, having overtaken smoking as the leading cause of premature death. If recent trends continue, by 2025, four of every five adults and one in three children will be overweight. The importance of activity is apparent, even before delving into the long list of other benefits to which exercise can justly lay claim. So what about participation in arts and culture? Well, actually, it's quite hard to measure in quite the same way that we can measure participation in sport. When you're reading a book, are you participating in the same way as when you're writing the book? I don't want to look at the front row because you'll have an answer to that, and I'm posing it more as a conundrum. Is writing the book, painting the picture, or performing the show the only true comparison with playing a sport or engaging in physical activity? Well, I've decided that rather than diverting into that complexity, a whole discrete topic of its own, I can say that what we do know is that 2.6 million Victorians are registered members of public libraries. And on average, every library member borrows 44 items per year. I hope my research is accurate because I've got the font of all knowledge here. What we know too is that 73% of Victorian children read for pleasure in their spare time. It's a lot of reading going on in this country and in this state. In 2015, well over half of all young adult Australians, that's aged between about 15 and 24, directly participated in cultural activities that included singing, dancing, acting, or playing an instrument. Pleasingly, the statistics show that that sort of participation remains strong right across our diverse population, whether we're talking about people from non-English speaking backgrounds, people who carry a disability, or people who come from low-income backgrounds. The figures hold steady all the way through. According to the American Public Health Journal, participants in the arts have been found to have improved mental health with lower rates of anxiety and lower rates of depression, higher rates of confidence, and stronger professional and personal communication skills. And so it's a happy conclusion that participation in either sport or the arts promotes good health. I can't see much to be gained, actually, in trying to measure the importance of good physical versus good mental health. it's more productive just to concede the crossover between the two. Good physical health obviously adds to our mental well-being, and good mental health makes us feel physically better. So turning from participation, we know too that millions of Victorians also watch sport and view the arts. We know that last year in Australia, nearly 8.5 million people attended AFL games, approximately 1.2 million attended the soccer, and the 2016 Australian Open just held in Melbourne had more than 1 million people go through its gates. Many millions watched televised versions of those and other sports such as cricket, rugby, netball, motor racing and golf. And of course, very many Victorians attended local community sport. When it comes to culture, although around 90% of all Victorians, that's more than 5.25 million people, have attended a cultural venue or event in the last year, 90% of all Victorians, I wonder if we all have a ready appreciation of those extraordinarily high numbers. The most popular, by the way, was the cinema, with more than 5.15 million Victorians attending at least once during the year. We also know that just under 2 million people visited the National Gallery of Victoria, which, by the way, and this is the old trustee in me, I can't help a little bit of crowing about how well they do, but it made our NGV the 25th most visited gallery in the world. An extraordinary accomplishment if you think where we are, and you give just a quick thought even to the large institutions around the world that we must outrank. I wouldn't dare stand here without coming to our magnificent state library noting that it too played host to nearly 1.8 million visitors of its very own. How gratifying that in the digital age, a library remains a centrepiece of the cultural life of a city and a draw card to so many people. Now, viewing sport or art is clearly different from participating. So, are there any benefits from simply watching? I know it shows no statistical rigour, but can I proffer the view, without relying on any definitive research on the topic, that watching sport or viewing art and artistic events is quite simply a very good thing? At the bare minimum, it's a happy distraction. We know we feel better seeing things that delight us. We know we feel better sharing social experiences with family and friends. And we know we feel better when we belong to a group or a team, and there is plenty of research about that. If the concept of joy is seen by some as a soft form of measure, and the way I've handled the health aspects should be seen as a soft form of measure, then let's talk about economics. In Victoria, the sports and recreation sector provides over $6 billion of economic activity on an annual basis. Interestingly, the arts and culture sector account for much the same, with the major contributions coming from film, electronic media, print, and literature. But there's also a much wider reach for both, with the integral role that they play in the psyche and the brand of our state. We claim that we're the sporting and cultural capital of Australia, and we use that proud boast as a major advertisement on the world stage. Without a Sydney Harbour Bridge or a Great Barrier Reef, we rely on our MCG and our other sporting arenas. We rely on the NGV and this library, of course, and we rely on our charming and magnificently stenciled laneways. And they all deliver in spades. By way of illustration, remember back a few years ago now, when Tiger Woods played the Australian Masters in Melbourne. He received a fee of $1.5 million, and that was considered somewhat controversial as a very high number at that time. But it was reported that the economic spin-off for the state was in the realm of $34 million. That seems like a fair return on investment. The National Gallery of Victoria is currently hosting the Andy Warhol and Ai Weiwei exhibition. So far, 176,000 visitors have been through the doors, exceeding every expectation. But the fact is that sport and the arts are collectively responsible for nearly 20% of the domestic visitors that come to our state. And of course, when our domestic and international neighbours flock to see sporting events or artistic events, they eat in our restaurants, stay in our hotels, and shop at our stores. So when you also take into account that well over 100,000 jobs in Victoria relate to arts and culture, and a similar figure to sport and physical recreation, the economic impact is palpably clear. So if you ever feel a little bit guilty about indulging in the delicious escapism of sport or of art, just remind yourself you're making an outstanding contribution to the economy of the state that we all love. Now, the Governor's role is a very privileged one, not least because of how much I see of life in my state. It provides a helicopter view, but from the ground up, if you'll forgive a dreadful mixing of metaphors. As I was halfway through, I knew I'd lost it. If I pause to reflect on my first 6 or 7 months in this role, I am struck by the centrality of both sport and art in the life of Victoria and of Victorians. On just the evening after my inauguration, I attended my first official engagement, a performance of the Victorian State Opera. Of course, it afforded me the opportunity, when I made a short speech afterwards, to say with complete honesty that it was at that point the finest artistic event that I had ever attended in my time as the Governor. Since then, amongst many other things, and this is truly just to give you a snapshot, I've officiated at the laying of the foundation stone for the Australian Ballet School's Marilyn Rowe House, hosted the winner of the 7th Melbourne International Chamber Music Competition, hosted those connected with the Indian Film Festival and also the Premier's Design Awards, and had the Box Hill Art Group to paint in our garden. I have attended the Melbourne International Film Festival, Treasures of Catherine the Great, Warhol Weiwei, listened to the Short Black Opera Company and the absolutely enchanting Dungala Children's Choir, seen the Rothschild Prayer Book exhibition at the Ian Potter Museum of Art, and marvelled at a performance of the Australian Orchestra. More importantly, and it's something sometimes in a beautiful building like this in the centre of Melbourne we forget about, I've seen the Central Goldfields Art Gallery at Maryborough, opened the framing of the Wimmera in Horsham, visited rehearsals for the Denali Gilbert and Sullivan Festival, visited the Piccoli Spanner Sculpture Garden, and I'm soon to visit the Streeton exhibition at Geelong and the newly painted wheat silos in Brim. And that really is a snapshot of just 6 months. What a rich variety of art offerings we have right across our state. Similarly, when it comes to sport, I've been fortunate enough to see Real Madrid play AS Roma, the first female jockey win the Melbourne Cup. I told everyone at a Government House reception on Cup Eve that they should back that horse. My phone went crazy after she'd won, but the only person who hadn't backed her was me. I'm still getting over that. I've seen, of course, Nat Fyfe, a very fine winner of the Brownlow, David Warner winning the Allan Border, the fantastic Australian Open, and soon the Grand Prix. I was happy to host AFL volunteers, and we attended a dinner that celebrated 90 years of Maccabi sport. But again, right across the state, I played croquet very badly at the Maryborough Croquet Club. There are some very vicious grannies down there. And I visited the Newbridge Football Netball Club, proudly rebuilt after the floods, the vibrant Wedderburn Football Netball and Hockey Club, the Natamuck Gymnastics Club, the Horsham Motorcycle Club, and the Rumbalara Football and Netball Club in Shepparton. It's an absolute treat and does again let you see what's happening right across sporting and recreational areas. And so, as Governor of Victoria, I can conclude proudly by saying how wonderful it is to live in a state where both sport and the arts truly flourish. How wonderful that our lifestyle, our agenda, and our political and democratic stability give us, on an occasion like this, the luxury to reflect on the intersection between sport and art as a topic of important debate and intellectual interest. And how wonderful that we're free to discuss this or any other issue that we want to discuss. How wonderful that neither sport nor art is compulsory. And how much more wonderful that neither is forbidden either. So in closing, let me just mention someone here close at hand who I deliberately hadn't mentioned right until now. I can't imagine a better role model than your president, John Wylie. Here is the president of Victoria's venerated Library Board of Victoria when he's been equally active as the chair of the comparably iconic Melbourne Cricket Club Trust, and he's of course chair of the Australian Sports Commission as well. So this institution need look no further than its own president as the embodiment of harmonious coexistence, and I don't know if his wife agrees, but harmonious coexistence and collaborative success between sport and art. Well, the final argument, I thought this library's collection may hold a key to the equality between sport and the arts in this state. In fact, my research has revealed that the collection here includes 185,000 items related to the arts. And when it comes to sport, 35,000. I was going to say that quite clearly it needed some extra footy records, but now I know it's got them all. So maybe just add in a few thousand copies of Kevin Sheedy's life story. One last thing. Gary Ablett Jr. and Caravaggio, I chose them just because I love their work. Each has a deft, disciplined, but still magic touch. I'm in awe of their respective talents, and I suspect they'd get on quite well together. They'd certainly both be on my guest list for that dinner party that we all fantasise about holding. Throw in Maradona and Picasso, and why not Ian Thorpe and Wei Wei? Perhaps I should stop there and let you all fantasise about your own dinners. Hopefully, such a dinner will go better than the one I mentioned at the outset this evening. Thank you very much.